Now, coming to the second part of this one, we'll look into how we can actually construct a belief network. So, in the last part, we have seen, we have described an example how we can construct a belief network. So, we have some idea. So, this will give you more concrete idea. So, when we try to develop any belief network, first steps will be to find out the set of random variables to describe the domains. Now we have to select the appropriate ordering of the variables. If we select the proper ordering, then it will be good, and if we cannot select the proper ordering, then the belief network can be pretty complex as well. So the typical steps that will be followed in incremental network construction is, we will choose a variable and we will add a node for it, and then we'll set the parents of X to some minimal set of existing nodes such that the conditional independence property is satisfied. So I will choose a node, I will add, and there may be already some nodes are added a priori. So for this new node, I will try to see which are the previous random variable that is influencing this one, and I will make this to be parent of this node. And then we try to define the conditional probability table. So if we proceed in this manner, we can actually construct the stuff. But the thing is, we have to select the appropriate ordering of the variables, because if we do not choose the proper ordering, then it can actually it can be pretty complex in that scenario. So let us take our famous example, the Berkeley and the Alam example, and we choose the variable ordering. In one case, this one, so Mary calls, John calls, and Alam, Berkeley, earthquake. And if we try to follow the steps incremental network construction, then we take this variable Mary calls, so which is the first one, so there will be no parents. Then we add the John calls. So now, looking into Mary calls and John calls, both will be actually dependent. So Mary calls has some influence on John calls, because if Mary calls, then there is a chance that John will also call. So Mary calls can have some influence on John calls. Now we have chosen Alam, and this Alam can be influenced by both of these two events, Mary calls and John calls, because they are interlinked with Alam. And the burglary, definitely Alam will be related with burglary. Mary calls and John calls probably does not directly influence burglary, but it will influence the Alam definitely. Now, earthquake, definitely Alam has some influence, in the sense that if Alam goes up, then it can be because of the earthquake. And since burglary and earthquake has some interrelation, because they are connected via Alam, because if Alam goes up, then I don't know whether it is because of burglary or the earthquake, so there can be some interrelation between these two. Now let us look into another set of ordering. So where Mary calls, John calls, earthquake, burglary, and Alam. So this part will remain the same. For earthquake, definitely Mary calls, John calls will have some influence on the earthquake, because both of them will eventually call, and we do not know on what reasons they have called. So it can be because of earthquake they can actually call. So there will be some dependency. Similarly, if there is a burglary, then earthquake has some influence, because through the Alam, Mary can actually have influence on the burglary because it will depend on the alarm. John calls can have influence on the burglary as well, and similarly and so forth. Now, one thing to note here, when I know alarm has gone off, then I can segregate these two events. But if I do not have any idea about alarm, then these two are actually related, and that I cannot actually say. So because if I do not know anything about alarm, then Mary calls can increase the probability of the burglary, or because that is quite understandable, because if the burglary happens, then Mary will call. So if Mary calls has a high probability, probably the burglary will also have the high probability. But here in this case, when I know alarm, then I can actually segregate out very easily. So therefore, the variable ordering is pretty important in order to have a very concise network. And if we can make that concise network, then probably getting the conditional probability table will be also easy, because here I have to give a conditional probability table something like P of E given J and Mary. So getting the probability of this one is actually difficult, and also here I have to give a probability something like burglary given earthquake, so which is also pretty difficult for me. So the choice ordering of the variable is pretty important in this scenario. Now, when we have this kind of belief network, we try to answer queries in these four patterns primarily. So here in these four diagrams, this Q basically represent the query that I am doing, and E is nothing but evidence given to me. So here, if you look in this, so this is the diagnostic one. So I have observed certain thing, and I want to find out with what probability it's because of this element. The causal relationship, like I have been given certain event, and I want to see under these circumstances what is the probability of this event. So this is the causal relation. Intercausal relation is something like I have given some evidence, and I want to know with what probability that this is also happening, and they are related through some kind of connected element, and there can be a mixed one. So I want to reason about this query, and it has been given to me, these two are the evidence for me. So typically these four kind of queries will be handled, and it will be variant of this one. Now when we try to find out the conditional independence, and that is the most important thing that we should look for, because if we can find out conditional independence, then we can simplify our computation. So given a DAC model, how to determine the conditional independence relation among the nodes and the variables? So DAC has the basic graphical patterns, so which is known as the canonical networks. So typically the network where we try to analyze will be of this form primarily. It can be a simple chain, it can be a kind of a fork, it can be kind of a V structure, and we would like to find out the dependency in this case. So if you look into this one, so if you look into z, z is dependent on y, y is also dependent on x. So but z is conditionally independent of x given y happens. If I know y, know whether y has happened or not, then I am not bothered about this x part. So I can actually simplify my computation. Similarly, y and z are actually independent here, provided I know x. And in this case, x will be governed by both y and z, but y and z are actually independent in this scenario. Now, how we can find out this conditional independence for a generic graph? So, in the previous one, we talked about the basic structure, and now we will give you more concrete example in order to find that stuff. So, we will use Bayes-Ball algorithm. So, what it does? It checks the conditional independence in a network using reachability. So how it is being performed? So a ball on a node in the graph can reach other nodes by moving along the edges. It can move in both direction according to some rules. So what are the rules? So some rules that we will see. The thing is, if the ball can reach from the start node to a target node, so basically I'll be given a graph and I will try to look into the dependency between these two. So this may be my source node, this may be my target node, so there will be some path between S and T. And there can be given some node which will represent as the shaded node, that just to represent kind of an observation of the evidence given to me. So if a ball can reach from start to a target node with observation in the graph, then S is not conditionally independent of T given the O. So the rules will be described in a moment. And if the ball cannot reach S to T, then they are conditionally independent. If they can reach, then they are not independent. If the ball cannot reach, then it will be independent one. So then the question is the ball movement. So what is the actual rule? The rules are pretty simple. Like when the ball bounces into an unshaded node, that means not a evidence node, then if it moves in the node through an edge in, it can only go out of the node through an edge out. So if I have a node, if I reach this node, so let's say this is my source and I'm sending one ball from this node to this one. So if the ball moves through edge in to another node, then it can go out only through an edge out. So it may happen that there is an edge something like this and there is a node, then the ball can actually pass to this node as well. But if there is a edge something like this and there is a node here, then the ball cannot move to this one. So this cannot actually happen. if it moves through an edge out, it can go out of the node through an edge either in or out. So sometimes it may happen that the ball actually moves to other node through an edge out, then it can actually go in any one of the direction, in or out. It's not bothered, so the ball can move in any direction. So this is applicable when we are looking into the unseeded nodes. Now when we look into the observation node or the evidence node, the rules are almost similar, but it is a reverse one. So if it moves through an edge in, then it can go out of the node only through edge in. And if it moves through edge out, then it cannot exit from the node. So let us look this stuff pictorially. So let's say I have this kind of situation and I want to see whether A and C are independent or not. Then I will have a ball at A which can actually move to B, and when I go to B, then it can move to C. But the thing is, the ball cannot move to D because it can go out of the node through an edge out. So A and C are dependent, but A and D can be independent. Now let us look into the other way. I want to see whether C depends on A or not, or C depends on D or not. So I move one ball from C to B and that passes through edge out. And now once the ball reaches to B, since it is reached to edge out, so it can go through either in or any kind of edge out. So it can move to both B and D. So effectively I can say that C is dependent on both A as well as D. Now let us look into the situation when some evidence has been given to me. So let's say B is given as evidence. Now I want to query between A and C. Now the ball will move from A to B, and from B it moves through an edge in, so it can go out of the node only through an edge in. So effectively then it can go to only D, it cannot go to C. And if you look into this structure, then definitely if B is given, then A and D are not independent, because if I observe B, then B can be influenced by A as well as D. So A and D definitely not independent anymore. Now moving forward, let's say if I have C, and then we would like to see what happens for A and D. From C, the ball can move to B, so it moves through an edge out. So if it is edge out, then it cannot exit from that node, so it is just stopped. So C is actually independent of A and D, because B is known to me, so I do not want to go any further. So I can say C is independent of A and D given B has happened. So now let us try to look into few situations like conditional independence in belief network. So with this one, so the problem is something like this. So I have a car which has a battery. The battery influences the radio and the ignition system, and if the ignition system works fine, then it can start, the machine can start, but to start the machine I need petrol as well. Now if I want to see that there is petrol and the radio plays, so these two events I can say are conditionally, are basically independent given the evidence whether the ignition actually takes place or not, or ignition actually takes place. So the thing is, if the ignition has takes place, then petrol and radio are actually independent, because ignition, so if I know the outcome of ignition, then ignition and then petrol and radio cannot influence each other, because then they have to link by petrol and radio can link by starts, but since I know ignition, so I just do not, I mean, so I can simply ignore the other part. But the thing is, petrol and radio are independent whether it is known that the battery actually works. So if I know battery works, then radio and petrol are actually independent. And also I can say, if for the same reason petrol and radio are independent given no evidence at all, because they will be independent. But the thing is, the moment I say petrol and radio are actually dependent, when it is known that the car starts, because if there is a petrol, then it will start. That means the ignition has to take place. If the ignition takes place, then it means the battery should be in the good condition. And if the battery is in good condition, the radio will also play. So this, if I know starts, then I can say, I can actually, I can say that they are dependent. Also, we can actually analyze this one through the baseball algorithm. Like, this is my source node, this is my, let's say, target node, and I move, and this is my shaded node, because given that the car starts, so the ball will move from this to here, the ball will move from this to here. The ball can also move from here, and this is a shaded node, and if I reach to a shaded node through an edge in, then I can choose any one of anything as my other stuff. So I can reach to this node. So effectively, these two are actually connected. So they are condition. So they are actually dependent, given the evidence that they start. And similarly, you can look into the other scenarios, and you can try to explain with baseball algorithm that it, you can convince yourself that it actually works. So if the car does not start, then the radio playing is increased evidence that we are out of petrol. So which is again also quite obvious, like if my car does not start, so this does not start, let's say, and somebody has said the radio is playing, then I can analyze, or I can reason, that the battery is working, so probably the ignition is also okay, and probably I am running out of petrol. So if the car does not start, then the radio is playing, then it increases the evidence that we are out of petrol. So this kind of queries that can be answer, or kind of diagnostic stuff can be commented on by analyzing such graph model. So with this, So in this part of the lecture, what we have seen, a belief network, how we can construct the belief network, and what is the good ordering of variables, and then we have seen conditional independent stuff, and we have also looked into the Bayes-Paul algorithm to find out the conditional independence. So given a graph, I can actually find out my by looking into the graph, I can actually say which nodes is independent of the other. But when I need to write a program, I need to have some algorithm, and Bayes-Paul algorithm can actually help in order to find out the given node, a given a set of nodes which are actually independent under the assumption of certain evidence. So with this, I will stop now. Thank you.